Hello everyone, welcome to our third lecture on molecular dynamics. Today I'm going to talk about periodic boundary conditions, temperature and pressure. A real macroscopic system contains around 10 to the power of 23 atoms, which is nowadays impossible to simulate using classical molecular dynamics. Usually, our standard sizes that we are able to simulate are around 10 to the power of 5 to 10 to the power of 6 atoms. And these relatively small systems in comparison with the reality introduce artifacts in our simulations. For example, let's assume this is our simulation box. We are assuming a cubic box which contains 50 atoms in each of the dimensions of the system. That means we have in total, in the full volume of the cube, we have 125,000 atoms, which is, let's say, a standard size nowadays in molecular dynamics simulations. Now, if we count the number of atoms we have on the faces of the cube, we will see we have 15,000 atoms on the surface. So that means 12% of the atoms of our system are interacting with the vacuum. So they are surrounded by vacuum if we have an isolated cube of atoms. Now, let's see the situation when we have a real system. Imagine we have a glass of water. If this is the case, let's say in a real system, we can assume also that we have a cubic shape of our glass. And we have maybe around 10 to the power of 8 atoms in each of the three dimensions of the system. Because if this is the case, in total, we have around 10 to the power of 24 atoms, which is equal to 10 mol. Okay, now if we do the same calculation as we did before, we will have 6 multiplied by 10 to the power of 16 atoms on the surfaces of the box. Which this number is very huge, but is a small number in comparison with the total number of atoms. Indeed, if you do the calculation, we have only 6 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 6 atoms interacting with the vacuum. So only a very small percentage of the atoms in our system are surrounded by vacuum, while in our simulation, a large amount of atoms are interacting with vacuum. So, of course, the results of our simulation cannot be directly compared with the results of a real system because in the real system, the large majority of atoms are interacting with other atoms, while in the simulation, a large amount of atoms are interacting with vacuum. In order to solve this situation, we use in molecular dynamics what is called periodic boundary conditions. So let's assume here in red we are representing our simulation box. So we will call it the primary cell. And here we have three molecules in different colors. This is just a simplification of our system. So when we use periodic boundary conditions, what we do is we replicate the system infinite amount of times in the three dimensions. Here, for simplicity, I only represent the situation in two dimensions, but in a real system, we replicate the primary cell in three dimensions. And then, when we run our simulation, we solve the Hamilton equations only for the primary cell. And then, everything which happens in the primary cell also happens in the replica cells. For example, if the molecule in red move in this way in the primary cell, we will see the same motion in the other cells. And for example, if the blue molecule leaves the primary cell, another blue molecule enters the primary cell from a replica cell. In this way, we conserve the number of atoms in each of the cells. Now, let's say we want to compute the interaction between the atoms, right? Indeed, we have seen in the previous lectures that we need to compute the potential energy in our system in order to solve the equations of motion. Let's assume that in the primary cell, we have, for example, 20,000 atoms, and now we will consider only the interactions with the 100 nearest image cells. If this is the case, we have to compute around 10 to the power of 12 interactions for each time step in our simulations, because in classical MD, the number of interactions scales with the square of the number of atoms approximately. So that means for each time step, we need to solve, we need to compute this very large amount of interactions. And remember, in classical MD, if we want to evolve our simulation for several hundreds of nanoseconds, we need to solve the equations of motion several millions of times. So at the end, the calculation is almost impossible to do from the computational point of view. So for this reason, we don't consider the 100 nearest image cells to compute interaction energies, but what we do is to define a cutoff, and we compute the interactions only with the atoms which are inside this cutoff. So, okay, let's say this is our primary cell, and the primary cell is defined by two vectors, Lx and Ly. Now we can define a cell vector called n as a linear combination of the dimensions of the primary cell. So with these cell vectors, we can define the position of any atom in any other cell of our simulation. For example, if we are in the primary cell, n1 and n2 will be equal to 0, so we have the 0, 0 vector to define our primary cell. Remember, here we are talking about two dimensions for simplicity, but we have, in reality, we have three dimensions. Now we will use the vector 1, 0 to represent the cell in the right, minus 1, 0 to represent the cell on the left of the primary cell, and so on. So we have a vector n which defines the position of each of the replica cells. Now with these cell vectors, we can define always the position of every atom of our system with respect to the position of the atoms in our primary cell. For example, let's focus now on this atom I here in the primary cell and on the same atom in the replica cell here. So the position of the atom in this cell, so this atom here, is equal to the position of the same atom in the primary cell, minus 1 Lx plus 1 Ly. So with this minus 1 plus 1, we are defining the position of this atom with respect to the position of the atom in the primary cell. Minus 1 because we need to go to the left on the x dimension, and plus 1 because we need to go up on the y direction. So regarding the momentum, as we said before, everything which is happening on the primary cell will also happen on the other cells. So that means the momentum of our atom in this cell minus 1, 1 is equal to the momentum of this atom in the cell 0, 0. And now, if we compute the interactions between atoms within the same cell, we have that the interaction between I and J in the primary cell is the same as the interaction between I and J in the cell minus 1, 1. Okay, so when we apply a cutoff for computing the interactions between atoms, we will have a problem because of this cutoff. So, as we have seen in a previous lecture, we will have interactions between the point charges of different atoms in our molecules, but also we will have interactions between the dipoles located at each of the atoms. We have seen that the interaction between the charges are modeled by the Coulomb potential, where Qi and Qj are the charges of each of the atoms, and R is the separation between the atoms. And as you know, these interactions are of long-range character. That means even at long separations, we still have an important interaction between the atoms. The interaction between the dipole moments are modeled by the so-called Lennard-Jones potential, which is a short-range character interaction, which means at long separations, the interaction between the atoms is close to zero, because, look at here, the variation of the negative part of the interaction changes with the power, with the sixth power of the separation between the atoms. So that means this decay is very, very fast. So Lennard-Jones interactions are short-range interactions. Now, we have said that we apply a cutoff in order to compute the interaction between the atoms in our system. In the case of the Lennard-Jones interactions, this cutoff doesn't introduce a significant error, because if we choose a cutoff of around, let's say, 12 or 14 angstroms, which is the usual case in molecular dynamics, the van der Waals interactions are already close to zero. So what we do usually is apply a switching function, which makes this Lennard-Jones potential equal to zero at the cutoff. So in here we are, let's say we have a small error because the interaction is not exactly zero at the cutoff, but it's very close to zero. So the error is very, very small. However, this is not the case for the Coulombic interactions, because as we said, Coulombic interactions are of long-range character. So at the cutoff, the interaction is likely still significant. And this difference between the real interaction and zero is very large. So we are introducing a significant error in our simulations, and also we are introducing discontinuities in the potential energy surface, because if at a particular time step the separation between two atoms is, let's say, this distance here, we still have a significant interaction, and then if in the next time step the separation increases until here, for example, now the interaction will be zero because of the cutoff. So we will have a strong change in the potential energy surface. So we will have a discontinuity in the potential energy surface, and the gradient on this discontinuity will be infinite. So we need to solve this problem. So let's say, let's analyze the situation in more detail. In the original cell, the total Coulomb energy between n atoms follows this equation. So here we have the summation over all the atoms in our system. We have a second summation with this condition in order to avoiding to count the interaction between the same atoms two times. Or we can write the summation like this, but then we divide over two, because in this way we are counting the interaction between ij and ji two times, but then we divide it among two. So then everything is fine. Okay, so this is the interaction between the atoms in the primary cell, so in the cell 0,0. Now, if we consider all the other simulation cells, we need to add here a third summation, which runs over all the cells in our system. And here, this prime here indicates that the term I is equal to j is not taken into account in the primary cell, because in the primary cell, an atom cannot interact with itself, but the atom I in the primary cell can interact with the atom I, which is located in other cell. So this prime only affects to the primary cell. Okay, equation 8 converges very, very slowly, and it is conditionally convergent. That means the result of the potential energy using equation 8 depends on the order we make the summation. And an additional problem is that equation 8 converges to minus or plus infinite if the unit cell is not neutral. And also this is a problem. So in order to solve all these problems related with the size of our system and related with the cutoff we are applying, usually we use what is called the Ewald summation. This is a very complex method, and here we are going to see only a very short explanation and a very, let's say, graphical explanation of the method. Okay, let's assume we have these three ions in our system. So we have two cations here and one negative charge here. Now we are going to represent the charge of our system with respect to the position of these ions. So if we are using a point charge force field, as it is usually the case, we will have a point charge at this position, another positive point charge at this position, and a negative point charge here. Okay, we are working in the real space. Later we will see that we need to work a bit on the reciprocal space. But for the moment, we are, let's say, in the normal space, in the real space. Okay, so we have said that the Coulombic interactions between charges are very difficult to compute because they are long-range interactions. So what we can do? So we will apply charge distributions of opposite signs, which will surround these charges. So for example, if we look at this negative charge, here we have the negative charge in this plot. So we are applying a charge distribution which is positive. And here, in order to screen these two positive charges, we are applying here these two distributions, which usually they have a Gaussian shape, in order to also screen the charge, this point charge here. Okay, so now we have these three ions with three charge distributions surrounding the ions, and these charge distributions somehow screen the interaction between the ions. So now we can compute the interaction between these ions, including the charge distribution which surround the charge. And now this interaction is easy to compute because we will have interactions which are of short range character because we are shielding the point charge of each of these atoms. Now, in the last step, we need to remove this charge distribution, which is not realistic. We only introduce this charge distribution to become the Coulombic interactions, short range interactions. So now we need to undo this alteration, and we introduce the same charge distributions but with opposite sign. So here we have this charge distribution which is negative, which will be counteract by this charge distribution which is positive here, and the same for this charge distribution and for this one. So we have here these two distributions which cancel the effect of these other two distributions. Okay, so this was the graphical explanation of the Ewald summation. Now, only a couple of things about the equations. So, we can write the interaction, the Coulombic interaction between the atoms in our system as equation 9. So, we will have three contributions. The direct contribution follows this equation, where here we are calculating the interaction between the charges, but taking into account the charge distributions which surround the point charges. So here we have here the error function, which is defined in this way. And this error function is the part of the function which makes equation 10 to the k very fast when n tends to infinite. That means when we have a very large amount of replica cells. Then the second part of equation 9, the interaction in the reciprocal space follows this equation, where now we are computing the interaction between the charge distribution in our system, but in the reciprocal space. So this vector m is a vector which belongs to the reciprocal space. So let's see in a bit more of detail this equation. So we have seen that our real space system can be defined by two vectors, by three vectors, if we are in the three-dimensional space. And these real space vectors are linear combination of the three dimensions of our system. So we can define a reciprocal space vector as a linear combination of three new vectors, bx, by, and bz, where these reciprocal space vectors are related with the real space vectors L by the following equations. So we can say that the reciprocal space is the Fourier transform of the real space, as for example the frequency is the Fourier transform of the time. So, and we need to compute part of the Coulomb interaction in the Ewald summation method using the reciprocal space. Finally, if we come back to equation 9, the last term we need to compute is a correction. It is called the correction potential, which follows this equation, which depends on the width of the Gaussians we are applying to shield the point charges in our system. Okay, so equations 9, 10, 12, and 16 form the Ewald summation algorithm, which nowadays it was improved several times with new formulations. But from a general point of view, I think this is enough. Okay, let's move to the next section. We will see now how we can control the temperature and the pressure along our molecular dynamics simulation. The temperature is related with the kinetic energy of the atoms in our system by the following equation. So the kinetic energy is 1/2 multiplied by the mass and the velocity for each of the atoms, the square of the velocity. And now, instead of the velocity, we can introduce here the momentum in our equation. And also, we know that the kinetic energy is 3/2 multiplied by the number of atoms in our system, the Boltzmann constant, and the temperature. So here we have two different ways of computing the kinetic energy. So we can write, if we take the right hand part of this equation and also this part of equation 17, we can write the temperature as 1/3 number of atoms, Boltzmann constant, and then the summation of the square of the momentum divided by the mass of each of the atoms in our system. So the temperature depends on the momenta of the atoms composing our system. So we can control the temperature if we control the momenta or the velocities in our system. So the simplest algorithm to control temperature is called velocity scaling, and it works as follows. So the velocity of a particular atom I at a time step t is computed from a previous velocity. Here we call it new and old, but this could be current time step and previous time step. So we compute the new velocity from an old velocity multiplied by a factor lambda. This lambda is equal to the root square of the desired temperature. So this is the temperature we want in our simulation, and divided by the temperature we have in the current time step. For example, if in a particular time step the temperature is too small, so it's smaller than the desired temperature, so this lambda here will be larger than 1, so the new velocity will be the old velocity multiplied by something larger than 1. So the new velocity will be larger. And this is a way to increase the temperature in our system, and this is what we want, because we were assuming that the temperature at the time step t was smaller than the desired temperature. So in this algorithm, the velocities are scaled every n time steps, and we need to choose this parameter n. Okay, we have more sophisticated thermostats, but they have, let's say, the same spirit. So the idea is to modify the velocities of the current time step, multiplying by a factor the velocities of previous time steps, in case they deviate a lot from the desired temperature. For example, in the Beresen thermostat, lambda follows this equation. It's a bit more complicated than the previous equation we have seen, but the idea is the same. And the Berenson thermostat tries to describe a coupling between the system and a hypothetical heat bath at the desired temperature. So here in this equation, tau is called the rise time and describes the strength of the coupling with this hypothetical heat bath. For example, if tau is large, here if tau is large, all this term will be close to zero, so lambda will be very similar to one, and the new velocity will be equal to the old velocity. So in other words, there is no coupling with the bath. However, if tau is very small, then the coupling will be very strong. So usually our simulations have a time step of 1 or 2 femtoseconds, and for these time steps, people usually use rise times of 0.1, 0.4 picoseconds. This is something we can choose in our simulation. The Andersen thermostat follows a different idea. So at a particular time step, we select some atoms in a random way and we change the velocities of these selected atoms for a velocity taken from the Boltzmann distribution at the desired temperature. Let's say this is our simulation box and here we have our atoms in different colors. So at a particular time step, we randomly choose, for example, the atom I and the atom J. We remove the velocities of these atoms and we assign new velocities to these two atoms. And the new velocities are chosen from a Boltzmann distribution at the desired temperature. So for example, this will be the velocity of the atom I and this will be the new velocity of the atom J. And the strength of the coupling between the system and the heat bath is specified by a parameter which is called the collision frequency, which describes the number of times an atom is selected along the simulation to modify its velocity. The last thermostat we are going to see is the Langevin thermostat. So here we modify the equations of motion to introduce the temperature control. So we have seen in a previous lecture that these two equations are the Hamilton equations we need to solve in order to know the time behavior of the coordinates and the time behavior of the momenta of each of the atoms in our system. So in the Langevin thermostat, we are going to modify equation 26 and now we introduce these two additional terms. So the first term tries to mimic the viscosity of our system. So here we have the friction coefficient multiplying the momenta. And the second term tries to mimic random collisions between atoms in our system. So these random forces apply to each of the atoms in our system are computed from a random number. And this random number is taken from a Gaussian distribution with the following variance. So the variance of the Gaussian depends on temperature and also depends on the friction coefficient of the atom we are applying the force. So in this way, we are introducing the temperature in our equations and we can control the temperature by modifying the random forces which are applied to each of the atoms in our system. These forces are applied every n steps along our simulation, which is defined by the so-called collision frequency. So this is a parameter that we also choose when we run the molecular dynamics simulation. So finally, let's see how we can control the pressure. So the pressure and the volume of our system are related by the virial equation. Here we have the equation where we have here the pressure, the molar volume, the ideal gas constant and the temperature. So the ideal gas equation will be up to here, up to the first term. So PV over RT is equal to 1, but the virial equation introduces additional terms which takes into account interactions between the atoms in our system. So the important thing here is that the pressure is related with the volume in our system. So in the same way, we can compute the temperature by modifying the velocities of our atoms. Now we can also compute the pressure by modifying the volume of our simulation box. And this is the spirit of most of the barostats. For example, in the Berenson barostat, we have the following situation. So this is our simulation box. The length of the box in this dimension is Li, for example. And now we are going to modify this length in order to control the pressure. So the new length of our box will be the length in the previous time step multiplied by a factor mu. And this factor depends on the difference between the desired pressure and the pressure we actually have in the current time step. So if this difference in the pressure is very large, so here we will have a very large number, and mu will be also then a large number, which will modify a lot the dimensions of our system. However, if the pressure difference is very small, then this will be close to zero and mu will be close to one, and we don't modify the dimensions of our simulation box. Here in this equation, gamma is the thermal compressibility of our system, and tau is the rise time, which describes the strength of the coupling between the system and the pressure bath. If tau is large, then the coupling is weak, and if tau is small, then the coupling with the pressure bath is large. So thank you very much for watching, and see you in the next tutorial.